The Prime Minister of Greece recently announced that he had reached a deal with his counterpart in Skopje, where the Republic of Macedonia would be renamed to the Republic of North Macedonia. In addition, the citizens of the country will be called, as before, Macedonians, while explicitly noting that they are not related to the ancient Macedonians. All these changes will be put to a referendum for Macedonian citizens in the autumn of 2018. Now, for most outsiders, this name dispute seems trivial. For the locals, however, it is a matter of national identity. I'm your host Shirvan, and welcome to Caspian Report. As a small, landlocked nation in the Balkans, the heartland of Macedonia sits by the Vardar Valley and is surrounded by mountainous terrain. In antiquity, part of this area came under the dominion of King Philip II of Macedon. His son, Alexander the Great, would expand the realm and establish one of the greatest empires in history. Which nation inherits the heritage of the ancient Macedonians sits at the heart of the dispute between Athens and Skopje. Although this question was periodically brought up throughout the course of the 19th and 20th centuries, the present dispute emerged in the 1990s with the breakup of Yugoslavia. For the first time in history, the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia became an independent state, and as nationalist sentiment surged, officials in Skopje tried to claim ownership over the name and legacy of ancient Macedonia and Alexander the Great by using historical symbols. Greece, however, which has its own region called Macedonia, objected to the name, flag, and state symbols that were chosen by the government in Skopje. Policymakers in Athens argued that the people in Macedonia, who speak a Slavic language that is similar to Bulgarian, do not have the right to identify as Macedonians. Athens argues that the ancient Macedonians were a Greek tribe who worshipped Greek gods, spoke the Greek language, and participated in the Greek-exclusive Olympic Games. As a counter-argument, Skopje says that history did not suddenly jump from the ancient Greek era to the modern age. A lot of changes happened in the centuries in between, and the residents of modern Macedonia identify as Macedonians. Nevertheless, from Greek perspective, the name is exclusively reserved for Greece. In addition, the government in Athens believes that the use of the name Macedonia by its northern neighbor would strengthen foreign territorial claims to the Greek-Macedonian region. This concern seems exaggerated, but it has some truth to it. In the aftermath of the Balkan Wars in 1913, the Ottoman provinces of Salonik and Monastir, which included all the territories of historical Macedonia, were divided among Bulgaria, Serbia, and Greece. In the years following World War II, Prime Minister Josip Broz Tito of Yugoslavia sought for ways to bypass the Strait of Otranto and gain direct access to the Mediterranean Sea. Greek officials believe that Tito devised a plan in cooperation with Greek communists to extend the administrative territory of Yugoslavia into northern Greece. In 1945, Tito established the People's Republic of Macedonia as one of the six states of Yugoslavia. By this, Tito had distanced the people in Macedonia from Bulgaria, which shared close linguistic ties. The name change also allowed for Yugoslavia to lay territorial claims on northern Greece, which had only been acquired by Athens a few decades earlier. Greece, which was caught off guard by this development, immediately joined NATO. As such, Tito's plan was never implemented, and an armed conflict between Yugoslavia and Greece never occurred. This history, however, illustrates the significance of names and how they play into identity politics in East Europe. It is also the motive behind the Greek objection. On the other hand, for Macedonians, the name dispute is perceived as a struggle for national identity. To clarify, its four larger neighbors, while they recognize the Macedonian state, have certain claims that undermine the nationhood of Macedonians. For instance, Bulgaria claims that the Macedonian language is based on Bulgarian, while Serbia claims that the Macedonian Orthodox Church is part of its respective church. Meanwhile, ethnic Albanians account for about a quarter of the total population, and Greece argues that there is no such thing as a non-Greek Macedonia. These narratives have persisted to this day. Some extreme factions go further and claim that since Macedonia has no language, no church, no name, they have no right to a nation-state. In this context, the people of Macedonia see the name dispute as a struggle for national identity. Still, there is more to this issue than meets the eye. Since the dispute emerged in the 1990s, relations between Athens and Skopje have taken a turn for the worse. The former demands that the name is changed or modified. The dispute is so meticulous that when Macedonia entered the UN as a member in 1993, the Greeks demanded that the Macedonian officials sit under the letter T, as in the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, while the Macedonians wanted to sit under the letter F, as in former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia. Eventually, the quarrel was settled in favor of the Greeks, and the UN admitted the country as the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia. To settle the name issue, a UN envoy has supervised years of negotiations between Greek and Macedonian officials. Over the course of the talks, several name proposals were made. But the deep nationalist attitudes that prevailed in both publics prevented the governments from reaching a deal. In 1995, Macedonia modified its flag and removed the Virgin as Sun, which is associated with Greek heritage. Yet, despite the compromise, relations worsened in the late 2000s when Athens blocked Skopje's efforts to join NATO and the European Union. The Macedonian government, under the nationalist VMRO-DPMNE party, responded by placing statues of ancient Macedonian figures across the country. Fortunately, in recent years, public attitudes have slightly relaxed with the electoral defeat of the nationalist parties in both countries. In Skopje, the center-left government of Prime Minister Zoran Zaev promised to strengthen the country's ties with the European Union and NATO. However, to gain access to these institutions, the Prime Minister had to settle the name dispute with Greece. To that end, shortly after taking office in May 2017, Zaev made symbolic concessions. He changed the name of the airport in the capital and the highway linking to Greece, both of which were named after Alexander the Great. These concessions signaled to the Greeks that Zaev was willing to resolve the dispute. Prime Minister Alexis Tsipras of Greece acted on this political opening, and this brings us to the recent diplomatic breakthrough. However, as is often the case in such disputes, not everyone agrees with the resolution. In Skopje, the name dispute is a matter of national identity, and based on this sentiment, the nationalist opposition argues that the ruling party is making too many concessions to the Greek government. What's more is that public support for the government and the opposition is virtually split in half. So, should Athens ask Skopje to modify its constitution, the Macedonian president, who belongs to the nationalist opposition camp, may decide to veto the agreement with Greece. This places Prime Minister Zaev between a rock and a hard place. He needs to bring his country closer to NATO and EU membership, but to do so, he must first settle the dispute with Greece. However, the volatility surrounding the issue and the divided public support risks splitting Macedonia's president and prime minister, thereby contributing to the collapse of the ruling government. In Athens, a similar political standoff exists. The country is governed by a coalition between the left-wing Syriza and the right-wing independent Greeks. Prime Minister Tsipras, who belongs to the former, said that he would agree to the inclusion of the word Macedonia in a compromise over the name dispute. The independent Greeks, however, reject a compromise that includes the word Macedonia in any form. They claim that Tsipras is too lenient in the talks. Thus, since the announcement of the diplomatic progress, the junior coalition partner has distanced itself from the ruling government. For instance, the defense minister of Greece, who belongs to the independent Greeks, stated that he opposes any compromise that includes the name Macedonia. This means that Prime Minister Tsipras, much like his counterpart Zaev, has little room for maneuver and is stuck in a political standoff that could break apart the governing coalition. In theory, The resolution for the Greek-Macedonian dispute is fairly straightforward. The real complication, however, is the internal political landscape. Whenever a solution seems accessible, the political opposition exploits the popular disapproval for its own electoral gains. It is due to this dilemma that the conflict has existed for so long. In fact, Alexander the Great conquered the ancient world in less time than it took Athens and Skopje to agree on a name. Today, a settlement seems within reach, but the proposal still has to pass the upcoming referendum. The outcome of such a popular vote will be difficult to predict. For people who are not vested in this conflict, it seems like a petty disagreement. Still, for Greeks and Macedonians, the use of the name is inherently connected to their core beliefs and national identities. And, as is often the case with identity politics, cultural sentiment can prevail over rational geopolitical needs. I have been your host Shirvan from Caspian Report. Credit goes to our contributors on Patreon for giving us the means to produce content like this. If you want to join our community and help support Caspian Report to remain independent, visit patreon.com/caspianreport. For now, thank you for your attention and Sarol.